Yeah.
Woo!
Yeah. That's just the entire summer we're saying. Somebody didn't shake out the dust. This is God's voice to me.
This is God's voice to me.
I am who it says I am.
I am who it says I am.
I can do what it says I can do.
I will study it.
God will transform me.
God will transform me.
Amen. Let's jump to Matthew chapter 22. That's actually the verse today. If you are here for the first time, I apologize that it's not in the bulletin, it's different. But we'll have it up here for you. Matthew 22. Should I apologize? I'm just glad you're here. Matthew 22, verse 34. Hearing that Jesus has silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. They think they're a little bit smarter than the Sadducees because they're sad, you see. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question. Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. Please take a moment to look at that. This is God's command to us. If we were to ask God, if God was standing right in front of us, and you said, God, what is your purpose? What do you want me to do? His answer would be, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind. Love your neighbor as yourself. That's it. That, in a nutshell, is the purpose of life. At least the explicit purpose of life. Next week, we'll talk about the implicit purpose of life. What does God want me to do? We'll talk about that more next week. But what God created every human being on earth to do was to love the Lord, our God, with all our heart, soul, strength, and mind, and to love our neighbor. How many of you have done that? Don't raise your hands. Otherwise, you're wrong. I'll tell you something. I actually obeyed part of this commandment. I obeyed the part that says, love your neighbor as yourself. But not necessarily the neighbor of myself. I love myself. While I was growing up, all I did was everything for myself. And as I share my testimony, I think you can kind of understand where I'm coming from. I was born in Korea and moved to the United States at the age of two. My father had left when I was 1 year old, made some money, and then brought my mother and me over. I was there at the age of two. We lived in a place called Flushing, New York. Flushing. But while I was there, I was actually the only Korean kid in the whole elementary school. So I was kind of very different in that sense. And I grew up in a Christian home. I think Christian was very kind of like, my mom, I felt like she was a great, great Christian. I would always catch her praying early in the morning, praying for me. Oh, God, save him, you know. My father, and I say this with all due respect, because I know my dad watches the sermon every Sunday. But at that time in his life, because he worked really hard, including my mom, I don't know how Christian he was. And my parents, like most Korean-Americans who had migrated to America, they had to work all day long. They would leave like 8 in the morning and come back like 8 o'clock at night. And so I believe up until third grade, I had a grandma who had a nanny who just watched over me. And then from third grade on, I was on my own, taking care of my five-year younger sister. But you know, my dad, my mom would come on daily time. And my dad would do the typical Korean-American dad thing. He would wear the nanggu. The boxer shorts, and he would put a newspaper, he'd eat, watch TV, and then that's it. I didn't really get much time to spend with my father. I didn't know who I was. Because it's our fathers who speak life into us. It's our parents who tell us who we are. And what I found oftentimes was I was not very pleasing to my dad. And that was kind of the situation of my formative years. But the only one thing I did enjoy was going to church, because it was a Korean church, there were a lot of Korean stairs. How the Korean kids have fun. By the time I became middle school, my mom and dad started to make money. And so we moved to a city called Roslyn, Long Island, Roslyn, New York. And it was a very, very affluent neighborhood. Very, very affluent. not only that, but it was very, very Caucasian. Jewish, Caucasian, upper class. Everybody drove like Mercedes-Benz, BMWs, and I'm talking about the kids, not the parents, the kids. And I didn't. But you know, my parents tried really, really hard to take care of us. But the day would once again have to go all the way to the city and drive back and take me home. But what I found out was when I was in Roslyn, being the only one of two other Korean kids at that time, the whole middle school, I faced racism. I started hearing words like chink, gook, slanty eye. And when I lived in Flushing, even though there were no Koreans, I never got that. There were Hispanics, African American, you know, we're just like one big, you know, melting pot. And when I moved to Long Island, it was like racism 101. But not only that, I was kind of chunky too. So I'm a chunky, not so rich, Asian guy, slanty eye. And I would look at all my other peers, all my other classmates, and they were blonde, blue eyes, athletic, and then they would be going out on dates, going to the ice cream parlor. And even if I tried to ask people on a date, they would say, no.